Hello there, it's Flower here. Yes, myself and Victor, we are in Brixton on continuing, I must say, with a mayoral trail. We've had to search for this man, but don't worry, we've managed to pin down Mayor Boris Johnson to find out what's his views, his last minute take, and why you should still vote for him. He hasn't been in our bed studios, but at least we found him, and let's hear what he has to say. Stay with us. I'm Flower. At long last, we've got the man in person here. It's taken a long while for us to track him down.
No, you met me. You were on my case the other day,
no, Ben TV. Ben TV, but I've been the one that's been doing all the correspondence regarding the mayorship.
Sure.
So it would have been good for you to come in. But still keeping fingers crossed, we might be able to get him into our studio. Well, of course, we're in Brixton at the moment. And earlier on, we were witnessing Boris just mingling with some apprenticeship young people and, of course, some women who were really just trying to learn English and so forth. Boris, we need to touch a little bit on housing.
Come on.
Because at the end of the day, one of the things that you've been accused of, or the community's been accused of, that they're trying to gentrify the whole community.
In here in Brixton?
Not only in Brixton, but, for example, in Tottenham area.
Yeah.
Now, we know that you're saying you're going to build houses and build houses, but with the welfare cap that we're seeing, you're going to see, in maybe a couple years' time, a lot of our community are going to be shifted out. What's your take on that?
Well, I don't want that to happen, and we're not actually seeing that yet, Flower. We're not seeing the kind of... I said I didn't want to see a Kosovo-style exodus, and we're not seeing that. But what we are seeing is huge pressure on housing in London. We've got to build much more housing in this city, and that's why we've got a plan to do 32,500 over the next 4 years, and not only build more affordable housing, but create 104,000 jobs at the same time. And yes, I want to see people able to stay in their neighbourhoods, and that means building more homes for social rent, but it also means helping people where they want to buy a little bit of a share of the value of their home as well. So we've done 25,000 part by part rent schemes which help people to get a little bit of the value of their property. I think we're also going to do even more in the next 4 years. But the critical thing is to get the funds from government to enable us to build more homes and to sort out the planning laws and the restrictions that are making it so difficult at the moment.
I mean, with the landlord situation, with a high, just really rental, it's bizarre. And you're getting a community that is really scared of breaking up. We're having families that could really, because of the welfare cap. So really, you think that's going to be enough? That's a bit long term. What about short term?
Well, short term, what we did was we delayed the impact of the benefit cap in London, and we got 100 million for London, so that to deal with the hard cases, so that people who need to live near their place of work or where their kids are in school can have special protections. And we got the ability to negotiate directly with the landlords, with the LHA, in order to drive the rents down. Now, I think the problem in London is the rents, and that they're out of control, and they need to be restrained. And the best way to do it is to get these landlords into accredited landlord schemes, where we can hold them to account and say and stop them from ripping off their tenants. We want to go up to 100,000 landlords on the accredited landlord scheme. But what I think would be a bad idea would be to try and produce measures to clamp down on the private rental sector. That means there's less housing for everybody.
I hear what you're saying. You've really just nicely led me into another area. Crime is something, come on, we're all scared of it. We want to see it stopped. But under your hospice, if you like, we saw what happened recently, of course, with Mark Duggan with the Tottenham area. Really ironically, we're actually in Brixton, where, you know, there's always been tendencies in the past.
Yeah.
The community have a lot of mixed feelings. We know that when you're elected again, or if you're elected or whatever, we know that the position of the mayor is going to be really powerful regarding to policing. We're seeing and hearing more and more racism, possibly racism within the force, stop and search. How are you going to appeal to the community and and say, well, I've got this under control.
I think that the most important thing to do is to be absolutely ruthless in stamping out racism of any kind. That's what Bernard Hogan Howe says he's doing, and I support him in that. The most important thing is for the Metropolitan Police to have the confidence of everybody in London. And they're not going to do that unless and until they really reflect London. And that's why I'm very proud to say that under me, actually, you've got more BAME officers in the Met than at any time before. We're recruiting more and more. We're promoting them now to senior ranks. And it's very important, this. We're going to have a scheme so that there's late entry. So people in the middle of their careers who might want to become a police officer, who've been doing something else from black and minority ethnic groups, who think, hey, I should be a police officer, we're going to put them in at senior levels. Because it's very, very important that the force represents London, reflects London. What I don't want to see, you know, you mentioned stop and search and I don't want to see us abandoning an important tool of an important tactic that is useful for restricting knife crime and stopping crimes of violence. But it's got to be done in the stop and search has got to be done in a sensitive and intelligence-led way. People have got to be polite, they've got to be respectful, they've got to do it in full accordance with the law. But we're not going to stop that. We are going to take those knives off the streets. And let me tell you something else. We're going to make sure that when people do break the law, and when people do carry a knife, and when people do threaten young people, then they are properly punished. And I'm going to set up a London sentencing unit so that we can see what happens to these people. Because too often they are getting away and getting out of the criminal justice system with hardly a rap on the knuckles. And they're coming back and they're reoffending again and again. And that is not good for our society, and I won't tolerate it. What we've got to do is when we do send these young people to young offender institutions like Feltham, we work to turn them round in that institution.
Is there going to be jobs for them, though, when they come out? Because that's not necessarily the case.
And yes, what we are also doing is working with business so that when young offenders come out of Feltham or come out of our prisons, they are given a chance. We have conferences now with business, and we say to them, listen, give these people a chance, take them on, you won't regret it, you can turn their lives around. And that's an expanding scheme that I want to take forward over the next 4 years. More generally, we need to be expanding our apprenticeship schemes. We're going to create 200,000 jobs in the future. In over 4 years, in housing, in transport, in regeneration, we're going to create 200,000 jobs. But I want young Londoners to get those jobs. Let me be absolutely honest with you, Flower. I want young people in our city. I don't want us endlessly to be attracting talented labour from other European countries to come and take those jobs. I'm all in favour of those people, but in the end, you know, there are people growing up in London who need to get those jobs. So you've got to get them into apprenticeships, and we've already done 54,000 over the last 18 months in all sorts of professions. I mean, I've just been talking to some guys who are joining accountants, headhunters, all sorts of things are now, all sorts of companies are now taking on apprentices.
Right,
and we want to do up to 100,000 by the end of this year, then another 250,000 over 4 years. I want our people, young Londoners, to have the skills, the motivation and the aptitude, you know, the mental hunger to get the jobs that are being created. And that is the most important thing we are in very tough times now, and that is jobs and growth are the number one priority for me.
Now, before I let you go, because I know there's a big rush for you to move on, the Olympics.
Am I boring you, Flower?
No,
have
no,
you had
no.
Enough
I would
of my
love to talk you to
have,
you
You've
more,
had enough of my rant about jobs,
no,
haven't you?
No. I would love to talk to you, but at the moment, let's get real. We've got the Olympics, and all of us, we're all dancing. Yeah, it's great for us. But at the end of the day, the small, medium business, the black minority, BME community, they're not going to take a piece of the pie, and they are screaming out. What are you saying to them?
Don't be so negative yet. Don't be so negative yet.
There's a hope.
There's a hope. I'll tell you why. In the course of the next few months, we're going to have people coming to London. We expect about 500,000 people to come from abroad, and maybe the total number of visitors is going to be 5.5 million. I think the figures I've seen from Visa say that over the Olympic Paralympic period, you're going to see $1.5 billion spent in London. Now, the businesses in London should be able to get some of that action.
It's too late in the day, though, because all the big contracts have gone. Even the small contracts have gone.
They haven't all gone yet. They haven't all gone yet. And I would urge businesses that would like a share of the pie, get onto the Compete4 website and see what's going. I think there are still thousands of contracts to be let. Now's the time to get going.
I know I need to wrap up. Listen, I want to say something to you. Shakespeare says that life's a stage and we're all here playing our little part. You've been doing it now for 4 years. How would you rate what you've done? And if you had a chance, would you make any changes?
When I look back over the last 4 years, I feel like we've begun a great project, but I want to carry it through. There's a huge range of investments that I want to continue with. I want to promote the improvements in the tube, the creation of new river crossings, regeneration sites across the whole of East London. There's a massive body of work that I want to go forward. And I genuinely believe that I'm the only candidate at this election that is really able to get the funding from government that London needs to take us forward. This is a city that generates huge amounts of cash for the rest of the UK economy, and it's high time that London got a proper share of the action. We export about 20 billion pounds worth of tax to the rest of the UK. You'd be better off spending that money in Brixton to drive jobs. You would. If you want to have jobs and growth in Strathclyde, spend the money here in Brixton. That's what I'm campaigning for. I'm campaigning for a better future for our city. Everybody will support me on May the 3rd, because I'm the candidate, I think, that has the best chance of leading London out of recession, of getting the best possible value from our Olympic investments, and creating 200,000 jobs over the next 4 years, getting the funds from government to give Londoners the future deserves, and to create jobs and prosperity for everybody in all communities in the greatest city on earth.
You've got one, sir. You've also the London Very Fund, going to help small businesses with low-cost loans.
The other thing is, of course, I don't get a vote on you because I don't live in London, but my business is here. So why can't I have a vote? My business is here. You're basically it's a
different. Well, it's been interesting. I know you've listened to the interview. As we said a few minutes ago, it's down to you to make that beeline vote. Come May the 3rd, make sure you make that vote. We can't tell you as people of BenTV who to vote for, but we'll say to you, don't waste it. We've given you the choices now. It's down to you. See you another time. Take care. Bye.